So now we are going to discuss today a small topic, and that is the muscle sternocleidomastoid. It is one of the muscles which I like because its origin and insertion is mentioned in its name itself. The origin and insertion is mentioned in its name. Sterno, one head from sternum. Cleido, another head is from the clavicle. And mastoid, the another head is from, the insertion is on the mastoid. So origin is somewhat like this. Here is the manubrium and then here is the clavicle. So from the lateral part of the manubrium, upper and lateral part of the manubrium is the sternal head. From the medial one-third superior surface of the clavicle is the clavicular head. So sternocleido. These are the two heads. Sternal head from manubrium and cleido, the clavicular head from the upper part of the medial one-third of the clavicle. And then the muscle takes origin and goes and gets inserted. Where does it get inserted? As suggested in the name, mastoid. Sternocleidomastoid. But insertion is not completely on the mastoid. Of course, it is on the tip of the superior border of the mastoid, from the tip to superior border, like this, it goes. But there is an aponeurosis also, which further goes to the superior nuchal line. This aponeurosis goes to the superior nuchal line. So insertion, like the biceps also, had an insertion on the radial tuberosity, and there is bicipital aponeurosis. So sternocleidomastoid also has insertion on mastoid, okay, from its tip to its superior border and the lateral half of the superior nuchal line. So that's about the sternocleidomastoid. What is the insertion? What is the nerve supply? The nerve supply of this muscle, comes from spinal accessory nerve. Okay. All of us know that the spinal accessory nerve, okay, it's a part of the 11th cranial nerve. It has two components, cranial and spinal. So that is the motor nerve supply. The sensory nerve supply comes from C2 and C3, the ventral rami of C2 and C3. Now, what are the actions of this muscle? Actions of these muscles are divided when one muscle is active, only when one muscle is active. So when one muscle is acting, what will it do? Now this is the head, and there is sternocleidomastoid running like this. Okay, so when it contracts, it turns the head, it will pull the head from here, so the head turns to the opposite side. Okay, turns head to opposite side. Like, suppose you are sitting in the classroom and the watch of the classroom is to the left side. So then your right sternocleidomastoid is on the left wall. Teacher is in front of you, but your right sternocleidomastoid will contract, and then you will be looking on the left side at the watch. If the watch is on the right side wall, your left sternocleidomastoid will contract and you will look on the right wall. When one muscle is acting, another action that happens is, this is the head, this is the sternocleidomastoid. It pulls it down. It pulls it down in such a way that the head, the ear will move towards the shoulder. Okay, so it tilts the head to the same side. Okay, it tilts the head to the same side. It has two actions, a rotatory action in which the head turns to the opposite side. But of course, you must have realized whenever the head turns to the opposite side, the ear, the head or tilts to the same side. Okay, so these are the two actions. The head tilts to the same side, head turns to the opposite side, and the head tilts towards the shoulder. The head tilts towards the shoulder. Now, the second action. So, one muscle acting independently when it contract. When both the muscles contract, the we are looking from the side. When both the muscles contract, the head moves forwards like while eating. So from your hand, whenever you are eating a burger, you are eating a sandwich, the head moves towards this. So that is happening when both the sternocleidomastoid, the head moves forwards. It draws the head forwards like eating, or sometimes whenever you are lifting your head from the pillow. Okay. And so there is another action, that when both muscles contracting together, because they're contracting from below, they will flex the neck. They will flex the neck, especially against resistance. Okay. And third action, it helps in forced inspiration. We say the attachment is to the manubrium and attachment is to the clavicle. So because it has attachment to the manubrium, during inspiration, the anterior end of the ribs have to be brought up. So normally it is done by the external intercostal muscle. But in forced inspiration, both the side muscles, they contract and they pull the manubrium up. By that pulling the upper ends of the anterior ends of the ribs upwards, so as to help in forced inspiration. So actions, there are three actions. When one muscle is acting, it turns the head to the opposite side, head tilts towards the shoulder. When both muscles are acting together, the head comes forwards. Okay, it brings the head forwards, like in eating, getting up from the bed, or it flexes the head. Okay, and when both the muscles contracting together, it helps in forced inspiration by pulling up the manubrium. The nerve supply, I have already told you. Now, there is one question that is asked. And along with this, applied anatomy of a sternocleidomastoid is torticollis. What is torticollis? If in case, there is damage to the nerve or damage to the muscle, and then there is fibrosis. Suppose the head of that person becomes tilted to one side. So the neck looks to be something like permanently flexed. Okay. Laterally flexed. The head is laterally flexed to the opposite side muscle, which has shortened. Okay, so this is due to damage to the muscle, and then there is fibrosis. So this needs to be corrected. There is one more component which is asked, like trapezius. There was a question called as structures deep to trapezius. So there will be a question called as structures deep to sternocleidomastoid. So once you have studied the posterior triangle, it is very easy for you. You know, so all those structures here will be under its cover. Like, for example, the structures under the sternocleidomastoid, skin. Okay. Then superficial fascia, platysma. So this is all the structures forming the roof. External jugular vein, structures in the roof of the. Then those four nerves of cervical plexus. Structures in the roof of the posterior tract. Okay, so these are the superficial structures in the sternocleidomastoid. Then there will be parotid gland. Then there will be deep structures. So what will be the deep structures? Mastoid. Then there will be carotid sheath. It is rather this muscle is the one which protects the carotid sheath. So even if somebody cuts the neck, a person doesn't die, because the sternocleidomastoid is protecting them most of the time. The person doesn't die exactly. Otherwise, if the cut is on the carotid, the person will die. Then it covers all these other short muscles of the neck, like sterno hyoid, sternothyroid, levator scapulis, peroneus capitis, semispinalis capitis. So all these muscles it is covering. Okay, which are the arteries it is covering? Common carotid artery, right? External carotid artery and its branches. So large number of structures, internal jugular vein. Okay, what are the nerves it is covering? Okay, the nerves which we have already discussed, but this was in the superficial part. But in the deeper part, the nerves it is protecting is vagus. Okay, the accessory nerve which is lying on the levator scapula. So you need not be too much scared about the if the question is asked on if structures under cover of sternocleidomastoid muscle, you have to just write the contents of the posterior triangle. You have to write these muscles, you have to write these nerves, you have to write these arteries and the carotid sheath. So that's all about the sternocleidomastoid. Thank you so much.